Everyone, welcome to the Stock Trading Tutor channel. If you would like to create a free Demat account, click the link in the description and fill out your details. Now, let's look at the important financial ratios needed for fundamental analysis. First, what is financial ratio analysis and interpretation? Now, ratio analysis can break down information on a company's financial statements. It helps reveal valuable information about a company's profitability, debt repayment ability, operational efficiency, and so on. Ratio analysis helps answer important questions like, is a company's stock valued appropriately given its growth prospects and the valuation of its competitor's stock? Is the company earning enough to meet its debt obligations and make profits for shareholders? Does the business have enough readily available funds to meet its short-term requirements? Is the company's operations efficient enough to maximize profits and avoid capital blockage? Now, let's look at which are the important ratios for financial analysis. First is price multiples, which are used to ascertain if the company's stock is fairly valued in comparison to the competitor's stock. Then, profitability ratios, which calculate the profit margins of the company. Liquidity ratios estimate the working capital position of the company. These are used to ascertain if a company has enough liquidity to finance its short-term operations. Efficiency ratios estimate the operational efficiency of a company. Risk ratios, that is, risk coverage ratios, evaluate a company's ability to meet its debt obligations. They also give indications about a company's ability to pay dividends. Now let's look at price multiples. Financial ratios that fall under this category are calculated by dividing a company's stock price by an important item on its income statement or balance sheet. They tell you how much you will be implicitly paying for each rupee of the financial statement item if you buy the stock. Since you want to pay the least amount possible, you should pick stocks with the lowest price multiples. These are called the undervalued stocks. Price multiples are calculated using many financial items like sales, cash flows, and total assets. But earnings and book value are the most commonly used. Now let's look at price to earnings ratio or the PE ratio. This is calculated by dividing the stock price by the earnings per share, which is also known as EPS. Now the EPS is calculated as net income divided by total number of shares. The PE ratio estimates the amount you have to pay to buy 1 rupee of a company's net income. Pick stocks with the lowest PE ratio because you will be paying the lowest amount of 1 rupee of its earning. Now let's look at the price to book value ratio or the PB ratio. The PE and other multiples calculated using the income statement items can be volatile due to frequent changes in the value of the income statement items. You can overcome this by looking at a price multiple based on a balance sheet figure like book value of equity. Book value is the total value of a company's equity as shown on the balance sheet. It includes the face value of its shares, retained earnings, certain reserves and comprehensive incomes that escape the income statement and go directly to the balance sheet. As in the case of EPS, book value too is converted into a per share form by dividing it by the number of outstanding shares. Now let's look at profitability ratios. These financial ratios calculate the profitability of a company based on various definitions of profit like gross profit, operating profit, net profit, and return on equity. Higher profitability ratios are better as they convey that the business is healthy and sound. These ratios include the gross profit margin, which is given by gross profit divided by sales. Then is the operating profit margin, which is calculated by operating profit divided by sales. Then there's the net profit margin, which is calculated by net profit divided by sales. And then there's the return on equity called the ROE, which is calculated by net profit divided by the average value of equity. Let's look at the liquidity ratios now. According to the principles of accounting, a company should match its short-term liabilities with current assets and long-term liabilities with fixed assets. For this, its current assets should be roughly equal to its current liabilities. Liquidity ratios calculate the ratio between a company's current assets and its current liabilities. Some of the commonly used liquidity ratios are current ratio, which is calculated by current assets divided by the current liabilities. Then is the quick ratio, which is calculated by cash plus short-term investments plus accounts receivable, which is whole divided by current liabilities. Then there's the cash ratio, which is calculated by cash plus short-term investments divided by the current liabilities. The current ratio compares current liabilities with all current assets, while the quick ratio and the cash ratio only consider the current assets that can be converted to cash the quickest. Cash ratio is the most stringent as it compares current liabilities with only cash and short-term investments. Quick ratio also considers accounts receivable, which is the amount a company has to receive from its customers. Now let's look at efficiency ratios or efficiency activity ratios. This assesses a company's operating efficiency. Operating efficiency is the time a company takes to convert its inventory into sales and repay its suppliers using the sales proceeds. The entire cycle of converting inventory to sales and paying suppliers is called the cash conversion cycle. Operating efficiency is important because the companies with short cash conversion cycles can complete more cycles in a year. This results in higher revenues. Converting inventory to sales quickly also helps companies receive revenue sooner and avoid borrowing money for operating expenses. You can estimate operating efficiency by either calculating the length of a company's cash conversion cycle or the number of cycles it completes in a year. You will need to calculate the following if you choose the first method, which requires inventory turnover. Now, inventory turnover is calculated by cost of goods sold divided by the average inventory. Next is the receivables turnover, which is calculated by sales revenue divided by the average accounts receivable. Next is the payables turnover, which is calculated by cost of goods sold plus opening inventory balance minus or subtracting the closing inventory balance, which is whole divided by the average accounts payable. Now, these ratios calculate efficiency at various stages of the cash conversion cycle. The second method involves calculating the number of days the company takes to complete each step of the cash conversion cycle. The following formulas are used for this. First is the days of inventory on hand, which is calculated by 365 divided by the inventory turnover ratio. Or the next one is the days of sales outstanding, which is calculated by 365 divided by the receivables turnover ratio. The number of days of payables is calculated by 365 divided by the payables turnover ratio. To calculate the number of days taken to completion to complete the entire cycle, you can use the following equation, which is cash conversion cycle, which is calculated by the DOH plus the DSO minus the DOP. That is, the days of inventory on hand plus the days of sales outstanding, subtracting the number of days of payables. Next, we'll see the risk ratios. Companies have two kinds of capital, equity and debt. Equity is the investment made by the shareholders and debt is the loans taken from the banks. Shareholders closely monitor a company's debt because high debt increases the chances of default. It also means that the company has to pay high interest, which would eat into their dividends and retained earnings. Risk ratios calculate the proportion of debt in a company's capital structure and assess the company's ability to repay its debt obligations. There are three important financial ratios that fall under this category. First is the debt to total capital ratio, which is calculated by the total debt divided by the total equity plus total debt. Then is the debt to equity ratio, which is calculated by total debt divided by the total equity. Next is the interest coverage ratio, which is calculated by the earnings before interest and tax, that is EBIT, divided by the interest expense for that period. Debt to total capital and debt to equity ratio calculate the extent of a company's indebtedness. High values for these ratios indicate a high risk for investors. The interest coverage ratio estimates a company's ability to repay its debt. A high interest coverage ratio means that the company generates enough earnings before interest and taxes to repay its debt. Thank you for watching this video. For more videos on stock market and trading, please subscribe to this channel. If you'd like to create a free Demat account for trading, click the link in the description and fill out your details.